Hello, this is Toxic Euphoria, and today I'm going to be giving a visual presentation of my Warlock flag strat.
Okay, it is time.
Any one of our players could get hit off the break. I'm going to specifically explain what should happen if our mid-right guy, for example, gets hit off the break. He's on spawn, and this is exactly what should go down. Now, if you remember the rules, the flank guys are only responsible for looking inside or across the map if they have a mid guy to protect them. The mid right guy is dead, therefore the right flank guy now needs to change what he's doing. The rules state that the right flank guy now must watch his respective right zone. So, the best position for him to do this would be portal. Off the break, our left flank guy was probably going to the left needler. And if you notice, from there, he can do not only his job of watching in towards the middle zone, but he can also watch across the map simultaneously, helping out our lonely right flank guy, until our mid-right guy spawns and is able to retake his job. Often in my strats, we use the flank that we already have to either retake our opposite flank or to preserve our opposite flank. In this case, we're preserving our right flank, who's lonely and trying to do his job, by using the flank that we already have in strength, our left flank. And so it burdens everybody just a little bit to have to cover that guy's job that we lost. Now, something I didn't explain was it just so happens on Warlock, the left flank guy doesn't have a shot on the right zone very well. Their plat blocks it out and he can't see it very well. But in that case, because it's Warlock, he could, instead of going to the needler in this case, he could step back into the left portal and, still doing his job looking into the middle, he would be on call. If the right flank guy needed help, he could port through and then help him out by shooting that zone. Using the term "we get back on our feet" in a way misleads someone who's trying to learn the strats. Because if you notice VOD on LAN, Carbon versus FB, the finals, there was two or three guys at the most on each team alive. And it just looked like chaos. It looked like they ran out to their flanks, ran out to their flanks, and they just kept dying and dying and dying. But it turns out FB got 5-0'd. And Carbon barely had three guys alive at any one time. So what I just explained against a good team is going to be constant. Constant. We're going to be missing one player on our team every, like, most of the time. And we're going to have to cope with that and go on and try to win the game. In a tournament or against a good team, we can't expect to wait for all four of our guys to be alive and set up before we move on with trying to win. Concerning what I just explained, dealing with the left flank guy who is on call to go through the portal and assist by shooting the right zone, that is just one of two options our left flank guy has in this specific scenario. The other option, which occurs on many maps, even on midship in some cases, if you're a flank guy and you're not able to shoot your opposite flank zone, this second option I'm about to explain would apply to any situation when that is the case. Sanctuary is another example when this may happen a lot, where you're not able to see your fellow flank guy's zone opposite from you because there's a big structure in the middle of the map blocking you out. So you'd have to choose another option instead of shooting across the map. This second option I've been referring to is actually pretty simple. It involves our existing mid guy to switch places with our missing mid guy. Now, for an important side note, always remember, and it's pretty obvious, that if there's a lot of action on the left zone as opposed to the right zone, that this left mid guy should not abandon his job. He's needed where the action is. Now, if there's a lot of action on the right zone and that lonely flank guy needs help, then our mid-left guy could leave his job and do what I just explained. Now, in case you haven't realized, having our mid-left guy switch positions with our dead mid-right guy is effectively going to flip-flop our current setup job-wise with every single player alive on the map. Now, because our mid-left guy abandoned his left zone job, our left flank guy now has to follow the rules. He knows that if he does not have a respective mid player to watch his zone, that he needs to do the job himself. Therefore, he's no longer obligated to look into the middle, but instead he needs to change and watch the left zone. Now, all that remains in order to complete the flip-flop is to have our right flank guy do the middle job. He knows, according to the rules, that as soon as he has a mid player, he's obligated to watch the middle zone. But, of course, he was probably taking a lot of pressure on the right side, which is why we had our mid player switch to the right in the first place. So, he may have to clean up the right zone before he obviously looks into the middle, you know. Believe it or not, the first half of this presentation has been irrelevant to how we're actually going to run things on Warlock Flag. Now, contrary to what you might be thinking, this has not been a waste of time, because not only did I reinstill in you what you already should have known, but I've built on top of that by introducing some new points. So only a portion of what I explained applies to our strat on Warlock. It was intended to be more of a reference example to use on other maps. Alright, now I'm going to elaborate a little bit on the most ideal setup for this map. And to help you understand how I came to my conclusion, I'm going to explain the variables and the dynamics thereof. Let's imagine for a moment that if you went in a portal, instead of coming out of the opposite portal, you came out of the adjacent portal. Walking manually all the way across the map is a waste of time. It's pointless. It's really inefficient. When you have the option to walk to a portal and instantly be transported to the other side, all areas in between become obsolete. But it just so happens that it's not that simple. There are three other big factors that influence strategy on this map. The first factor I'm talking about is that when you walk into a portal, instead of coming out of the adjacent one, you come out of the opposite portal. This crisscross effect results in a theoretic twist of the strategy behind the map. This twisted theory, when considered in symmetric isolation, is very simple to plan around. But when you start dealing with other asymmetric factors, such as unbalanced zones, the strategic picture becomes way blurry. The second out of the three factors I'm explaining is the distance to the portal and the requirement of having a mid player to protect the left and right zones. And finally, the third factor I was talking about concerns the asymmetrical zones. At first glance, placing our flank guys in the portal here and here seems like the perfect plan. But when you look at it harder, you begin to realize how lopsided their zones are, and it's just too hard for them to do one of their jobs. For example, our left flank guy in this position can do his job of watching the mid zone perfectly, but when it comes time for him to watch the left zone, the left ramp blocks out his view, and his field of view is so narrow that by the time he sees an opponent, they're pretty much on their way through the portal. But before I further explain this third factor and how to solve the problems caused by it, you'll need to orient your thinking with the zone differences. Going by the mid-left guy's field of view, you'll notice that the zone starts here and then ends right here, just before the portal. Now, when you compare that to the mid-right guy's field of view, the zone starts here and ends right about here. And if you notice, it overlaps the portal, meaning the portal should be included in the definition of the right zone. In other words, when you cover the right zone, one of the guys on your team are going to have to look at our ramp portal in order to do that job effectively, because in that amount of time, the opponent could go halfway through the zone and be ported through into our side, and we'll need somebody to shoot that. After coming to realize all these different asymmetrical variables, you can see how the twisting effect of the portals can destroy the simple strategy that you once had. Alright, back to solving each player's job dilemma. When it comes time for the left flank guy to clean up or hold the left zone, he does not have a shot. The ramp blocks him out, like I said. But, however, he can shoot into the middle. So what this comes down to is he is only 50% effective in this position. He can only do one of his two jobs. Therefore, he's 50% of a left flank guy. Not too efficient. So, in light of this dilemma, there are actually three options we could choose to fix the problem. And these three options could be thought of as three different ways to set up our team. Because the complexity of Warlock gives us a little bit of a flexibility to where there's actually three different ways we can run things and still accomplish our goal pretty much with the same efficiency. But, with that said, there must be one perfect way to set up. Like, if there was a god that wanted to run a strat, these strats and set up, he would do it this way. This third strategic option actually deals with what I was talking about earlier, concerning how there's portions of the map that are obsolete, that it's pointless to even go in these areas. Exerting your attention or movement in anywhere on the map that isn't labeled obsolete translates into more work getting done more effectively. But, of course, there will be times in the game where you'll need to go into these areas, such as on a plat, to support a player inserting or something to that effect. So, obviously, they're not like a dead zone. You can use them to your advantage sometimes in the game. Okay, so our left flank guy is only 50% effective, because he can only do one of his two jobs. But you can't lose hope for him being positioned in this portal yet. Because after all, he's one step away from all of a sudden being transported across the map into a better forward position. And that's a lot of ground to be covered in an instant. He otherwise would have to walk all the way to the opposing portal, which can be accomplished in an instant. So we don't want to throw away his position in a portal just yet, because it's a really efficient way to move. Now, if you notice in this current position, he can't see the middle zone very good, but, however, he can watch the right zone perfectly. In case he didn't pick up on this, on the opposite side of this portal, he was in the exact opposite dilemma. He couldn't watch the left zone while he had a pretty good shot of the middle zone. And that's an exact mirror of his dilemma right now. So now, because of the theoretic twist that this portal system has on the strategy, he becomes the right flank guy. So he is not only a 50% left flank guy, but once he ports through, he's 50% right flank guy. Now this might be simple enough to understand, but it gets a little more complicated. He is actually the one that will be inserting. So what it comes down to is not only is he a part left flank guy, part right flank guy, but he also is responsible for inserting, and therefore he's also part mid right guy. Alright, so that you don't freak out, before I go any further, I'm going to explain how I'm going to simplify this technique, this strategy. Off the break, wherever you run, what you're already familiar with, is what you're going to be known as. So if I run to the left portal because I'm closer, I'm going to say I got left flank. All right? And the guy that I just explained is in fact going to be known only as left flank guy. Even though he does part left flank guy's job, part right flank guy's job, and he inserts part mid-right guy's job, he's only going to be known as the left flank guy. Now, the only way this will work is if you memorize priorities. So, me as a left flank guy in our ramp port, I know that if I hear right zone is hot, I gotta immediately drop what I'm doing and port through and shoot the right zone. And likewise, if I hear middle, then I'm going to port back through to our ramp portal and then shoot into the middle. And then, me as a left flank guy, if I see an opportunity to insert and I have support, then I'm going to go ahead and insert to grab the flag. But through all this, I'm going to be known solely as left flank guy. And if I die, the mid guy needs to fill my position, and he will now be the left flank guy. It's pretty simple. You just got to memorize priorities. Okay, now to explain the mid-right guy. He is part mid-right guy, naturally, and part right flank guy. About 50% of his efforts, if not more, should be focused on watching the right zone. When there's an opponent that enters the right zone, he tells our left flank guy, who then ports through and cleans up the right zone for him. Now, when our left flank guy ports through to help clean up the right zone, our mid-right guy now has an opportunity to look inside, therefore completing the right flank guy's description, his job, which is to watch the middle zone. A good spot to watch their needler spawn, or that middle zone, is on the right ramp. From here, it's just another couple of steps before he's on to the right plat, where it's actually a really good support position for our left flank guy to insert through the right zone. So that mid-right guy transitions and does the job of a right flank guy and supports that insert. And from here, he can watch the needles spawn as well as across at the left zone. From here on this plat, he can also support the guy who inserted's journey with the flag back across top mid, and our mid-right guy would then transition back where he came up, down onto the right ramp, and from here he can watch the left needler spawn, because they tend to spawn there when we're in their base. And then, once we cap the flag, he's finally back to where he started, doing his default job of watching the right zone again. Okay, now it's time to explain the right flank guy. Positioned in our B port, the right flank guy does not have a very good shot on the middle, and so he cannot do that part of his job as a right flank guy. But, however, he can see the right zone pretty well. Although he is far away from it, the two players that are watching the zone, the mid-right guy and our left flank guy in their ramp port, those two players have a hard enough time watching that zone just because of the proximity, and you know, they can't see that zone very well. It's the hardest zone to watch. Therefore, it's pretty convenient to have our right flank guy's default job to be watching right zone to help them out. And technically, with him doing that, he's assisting our mid-right guy. So he's part mid-right guy at this moment doing his default job. With our right flank guy in this position, he's actually pretty limited. So as soon as he gets a chance, he needs to port through immediately. Now in this position, he can very effectively watch the mid-zone as well as the left zone. Now both of those jobs fall within the realm of a left flank guy's responsibility. And on top of this, he can also watch the right zone fairly well. Okay, so the way it breaks down is, off the break, our right flank guy plays the role of the right flank guy, shooting in towards the middle. Once he gets in the portal, he then plays the role of a mid-right guy. Then, once he ports through, he plays both of the roles of a left flank guy. Now, it comes time for him to insert, of which he then plays the role of the mid-left guy inserting through the left zone. So with this flexibility comes greater responsibility, whereas the other players on the team have the luxury of focusing on one or two things instead of maybe four, and trying to choose between the four. He, on the other hand, has to focus on a broader spectrum of communication, taking information from every single player on the map, instead of just a mid player. Alright, finally, last but not least, I'm gonna describe the mid-left guy. The way he operates in this system is he's actually an exact mirror of our mid-right guy. So what I explained with our mid-right guy, I'm just gonna be emulating on the left side. Off the break, he ideally goes top mid. From here, he can do his job quite well and safely. Now, his default job is to watch the left zone, looking outward, fitting the definition of a mid-left player. Our mid-left guy, in top mid, then has the opportunity to jump onto the left plat. From here, he's in a position to support our right flank guy, who's going to insert into the left zone to grab the flag. But also from the plat, he's in a good position to look inside at their needler spawn, in effect, doing the left flank guy's job. Together, the roles that our mid-left guy plays could be broken down into 50% left flank and somewhere around the lines of 50% mid-left. Still on the plat, our mid-left guy can support the insert, like I said, and gradually fall back into his primary on our ramp. This way, he stays safe as we pull out the flag across top middle, and then, by the time we cap the flag, he's pretty much set up to jump top mid again and reset, doing his default job of watching the left zone. So, in conclusion, the way it works out with the dynamics of Warlock Flag is that each player on the map is only able to handle a portion of their individual responsibilities. But, however, they are also able to handle an equal portion of their teammates' responsibilities. So by divvying out the work equally, we ensure that every job will be done all the time, and that each player will be raping to his fullest extent. Alright, time to simplify things. Gotta organize the system in order for it to work. So, I'm gonna go through each player, left flank, right flank, mid-left, mid-right, and explain their priorities. This will ensure that they're looking in the right spot at the right moment and doing the right job at the right time.